the idea of working with Whitney and Kevin was so exciting to me. Artists who are at the top of their game, and I was going to bring my game to that too. My name is Susan Ininger, and I'm a costume designer. Prior to meeting Mick Jackson for The Bodyguard, I really hadn't worked on a huge film, so this was my lifetime dream. I got a call from the director's assistant saying, Mick loves your work, and he'd like to meet with you. So when I went in for the meeting with him, they just started talking to me about the movie. There was actually no interview. And I don't remember being intimidated or anything like that about meeting with them, because Mick and Jeffrey spoke my language completely. I mean, they just started talking to me creatively about what they wanted Queen of the Night to be. That was basically the first topic that we talked about. And I think that is why Mick decided to hire me, because he knew that I could bring this other dimension and other attitude towards the costume. And it was a great collaboration with them. As we developed the character of Rachel Maron, basically we made three closets for her. One was her show costumes, her stage costumes. One was her celebrity costume, so when she was out in public, going to restaurant or going to the Academy Awards. And then we had her clothes that she would just wear at home, working, relaxing, etc. We brought in a lot of fashion pieces from Europe that wouldn't be seen here in the United States. Everything needed to be very unique to set the character, Rachel, apart from everybody else. My first conversation with Mick Jackson and Jeffrey Beecroft was about the Queen of the Night costume. And their inspiration for that was the visuals from Metropolis, which is a 1927 German film, and Terry Moogler, who was a designer designing a lot of breastplates, hard pieces incorporated into his fashion designs. We also talked about Whitney and her movements and what would make her feel regal. After designing and creating the Queen of the Night costume and shooting the Queen of the Night video, I was asked to scale back the Queen of the Night costume. Just before we were preparing to shoot a scene where Whitney performs at her friend's show. She's a guest artist. And because it wasn't her venue, it was her friend's, and she should maybe be a little quieter, if you could ask Rachel Maron to be quiet. So we redesigned over a weekend. We added a beaded skirt to it. We took away all the big fans on the back. We cut back the helmet, so it was more Rachel Maron casual. And she performed in that. I know that Mick Jackson, he came up with the beaded skirt, and that provided another story element with this stalker that Rachel Maron had, because the beads of the skirt broke when she was body surfing in the crowd after her performance. And that bead became a key point, as I recall. We did create a dichotomy or contrast between the Queen of the Night with the armor and very protected in her gloriousness, and the Run to You costume, which was basically no costume, just a piece of chiffon across her. The video Run to You was meant to be a view of Rachel Maron's vulnerability, and it was played at a pivotal moment in the film where Kevin is watching the video late at night by himself. And was that the moment that he fell in love with her? I don't know. But what I remember about the costuming for Run to You, I think the original costume, I had done some sketches of what she might wear, very minimal unitard kind of things, maybe with some clouds painted on it or something like that, kind of surreal. And yet we ended up with just a piece of white chiffon. I think it was very effective because it flowed in a lovely way that added to that romantic kind of feeling, and yet she basically looked very vulnerable and naked under this piece of chiffon. Looking back at the film, it's always important that for the life of the film, for the life of the story, to carry on and be effective and meaningful for the audience for years and years and years, it's important for the looks of the film to be very classic and to be able to transcend styles from different decade to decade. And I think we pretty much accomplished that. Of all the costumes that I designed for Whitney that she wore in The Bodyguard, there were a couple of costumes that I would have liked to have seen more of in the final cut. Not my choice, so one of them was the Queen of the Night, of course. We never saw in the film the full Queen of the Night costume. That was only seen in the video, which was in the background when they were shooting principal photography. So that was one disappointment, but I totally understand for the story. It all worked out the way it should. The other costume that would have been great to see more of is the I Have Nothing costume that she wore at the Fontainebleau Ballroom. And it was, we saw the camera sweep across, saw her from the back with the audience in front of her. And it was a beautiful shot, but we didn't see a whole lot of it. I have to give it to Whitney always, always, always that these costumes were not easy to wear, but she always pulled it off. The first time I met Whitney was on the stage at Warner Brothers during pre-production. I had been tasked with what we call a show and tell. And I had maybe 5 or 6 racks of clothes, tables laid out with my sketches and tear sheet references. And I remember so distinctly when Whitney arrived and I took her over to start showing her some of the work that Mick and I had already been doing. And she said, oh, I just want you to know that I can bring anything that you need. I have a lot of clothes, you know, sort of thing. And I turned to her and I said, thank you so much. But I think we need to stay focused on the fact that we are creating Rachel Maron and this character. And she totally got it. She just totally understood right away. When I work with an actor, there has to be a trust. And we have to develop that right away. When I showed Whitney the designs initially for Rachel Maron, she saw them with a very open heart. And I felt that right away. And we continued to build on that. That ability to trust and to still perform your, it's a magic that actors bring to the set. And I thought that Whitney was phenomenal in, I mean, we all knew her music, we all knew her voice, but then this was yet another beautiful talent that she had. And I know it wasn't easy at times for her, but she always rallied through. The other thing that really impressed me about Whitney was that she understood that I had a lot of other characters in the movie to costume, and she never demanded more attention from me than I had to give her. She did have a hard time getting up in the morning. The hours of shooting were different than the music industry, I think. But she rallied. She was always there. She always understood what we were trying to evoke. Until we shot I Will Always Love You, she was always able to find something that she liked. The shots were very, very close. So that was the only time that she asked me if she could wear one of her own gowns. My favorite part of working with a really talented artist is getting to know the person behind, in this case, the voice and the beautiful exterior that Whitney carried with her. And underneath that, she was humble. She was committed to the project, which always resonates with me as an artist. My favorite memory of Whitney is when we were in Miami and we were preparing to shoot I Have Nothing, and she was wearing a dress that weighed about 50 pounds. And I had bracelets that wound up her arm. One of the bracelets was breaking. And we were backstage in a little boiler room, and she was just hanging in there. When the bracelet broke, she just said, Susan, don't worry about it. And she went out there and sang her heart out like she always did. She came to this project with such an open heart. She just absorbed, absorbed, absorbed. She had that special characteristic of transformation.